Now, the purpose of this is to look at the whole and look at the whole. And some of you, for some of you, this will be like kindergarten. But the goal of this talk is to get some kind of in Polish całokształt, the whole, a sense of this whole. And I'm coming to it. Because I do this a lot through, and this is a factor here too. You're looking at the past, you're looking at the Jewish world of the past, but you're also looking at it through the eyes of the Holocaust. And that's you can't be in Poland as a Jew or someone interested in Jewish culture and of course not take that into account. So one of the problems of this, of course, is that you don't, you talk about the destruction so much that those destroyed can easily become featureless, right? Numbers, ciphers, the victims, simply victims. So the idea of this thing is to try to restore some of the historical features of these victims. We have this phrase, the 6 million, right? And not just in Holocaust studies, but in the world as a whole. It's rooted in our language, in the way we narrate our collective past. And it's become one of the spoken and increasingly one of the unspoken assumptions, the givens for every discussion of our world. And but even as those words, the 6 million, the centrality of those has grown, they seem to mask neutralize, right, the historical reality. So when you think of all those Holocaust memorials we've stood in front of, especially in the United States, an iconography of broken limbs, clawing fingers, mouths stretched wide in horror, the 6 million, interchangeable, right, victims. So who were they? Well, certainly they were 6 million individuals. Six million people born, we'd like to assume, with the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, same as us. 6 million souls, if you will. But again, from this perspective, they're interchangeable. They were Jews, of course, but what does that tell us other than the fact that they celebrated certain holidays, certain life cycle events in ways similar to Jews who, to people who call themselves Jews today. So what I want to do with you is to recover a bit of what it was that made those 6 million absolutely unique, absolutely irreplaceable. And to do this, I'll focus on them not as individuals, but as the creators of a world, creators of, in fact, a civilization that flourished for most of 1,000 years. And this will be reinforced, and there's a place to reinforce this story now, and that will be in Warsaw when we go to the Museum of the History of Polish Jews, which is, about that. But one of the results of thinking this way, it will be, of course, to deepen our sense of what's been lost. So we'll start a little bit with geography. So they weren't just Jews in general. They were European Jews, and we can be more specific than that. Fully half of them, 3 million of them, were citizens of the pre-war nation state called Poland. Add to this those who lived in the Soviet Union and the Baltic countries, and we have 2.3 million more. So altogether, 5.3 million, about 90% of the victims, Eastern European Jews. And this is the world, let's remind ourselves, this is the world from which nearly all American Jews, nearly all European Jews today, half of all Israeli Jews are from. From a slightly different perspective, in 1939, on the eve of World War II, about 85% of all the Jews in the world were either living in Eastern Europe or immediately descended from Jews of Eastern Europe. So, and then today though, with some exceptions, and the exceptions are, in this room to a large extent, and, people under, who do these kinds of studies, this whole world is at best shrouded in mythology. People think of Tevye, and at worst, it's entirely forgotten. So let's start. Let's start. Consider a vast geographical area where today the following nation states exist. Here we are. Whoop, no, tylko trzeba. Oh, lepiej tak. Yeah, that's better. So we have Poland, we have the Baltic states, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania. Mainly we're interested in Latvia and Lithuania. We have Belarus, we have Ukraine, well, of course, Moldova, which back then was called Bessarabia. Wine, women, and song—they call people call that area. Romania, of course, a little bit of here, the northern part, this part of Hungary and Slovakia, and part of the Czech Republic as well. So we're looking at a really vast area that whose unity was historical, and we're gonna just attempt to, you know, for centuries and centuries, Jews lived in those lands. But there was a historical unity. That was a political unity, and so let's go back a little ways. Proszę, 45, może to. A czy ja mogę sam to? Nie, ja nie mogę. Okay, so this is Europe in 1945. You know, the layout of the countries is about the same, except there's something called the Soviet Union. Which has within it all those, the Baltic republics and Belarus. And so the borders really haven't changed, except in Czechoslovakia, where there's one state that includes Czechs and Slovaks. All right, teraz jeszcze wstecz. So here is, zaraz, nie, jeszcze, oh, 20, tak jest. So this is this world in the 1920s and 30s, and we have a Poland whose shape is entirely quite a bit different from what it is today. What's happened is that after World War II, the eastern part of Poland goes this way into becomes part of Belarus and Ukraine, and the western part of Poland gets enlarged and annexes good parts of Germany. And then, you know, this little piece of Germany, of course, is no longer there. And here's Czechoslovakia, here's Hungary, Romania. So this is the interwar when nation states first started developing. Then let's go back one more to Eastern Europe in 1815. And we have a world divided into three empires. See, the Prussian Empire, the Austrian Empire, and of course, the Russian Empire, which really includes what they call Poland here, Kongresówka, Western. So this was the, you know, the ethnically Polish part, and here's the rest of the. Now in here, this thing here, the eastern or the western parts of the Russian Empire, was what became known as the Pale of Settlement. Where Jews were pale. Pale of Settlement, it translates a Russian phrase. It's simply, Pale of Settlement was where the Jews had always lived and now were required to live because the Russian Tsars were afraid of them moving, polluting the eastern, the motherland of Russia. By the way, if you have any questions, you can feel free to ask them. If I'm in the middle of doing something, you know, I'll finish, but then, you know, feel free to ask. Może jeszcze teraz wstecz. Oh, jeszcze, poczekaj, sekundeczkę. And here, you can see, also, in the Austrian Empire, it's worth pointing out, the province of Galicia. Okay, very important. So, we're looking at really one area here where the Jews, that is the important part of this. All right, now let's go back one more. Okay, so here is the world of 1740. Let's go back one more to 1600, and you'll see this is, now you see something called the Commonwealth of Poland and Lithuania at its largest extent. It's a huge state. It's, in Polish, it's Rzeczpospolita, which is translated as Commonwealth. It was something that was neither an empire nor a nation state. Of course, empires are a feature of the 19th century, and nation states are a feature of the 20th century, and if you're in Western Europe, of course, they go back earlier. But this was something else. This was a parliamentary republic of the Polish nobility, of the Polish landowners. And this, when we talk about the Polish lands, Polish-Lithuanian lands, this is where the culture we're talking about rooted itself. And at first it was the Kingdom of Poland, Lithuania, Poland, then Lithuania came in the 1300s, and then the whole thing became, from 1586 on, was the Commonwealth and this lasted until its dismemberment by those empires we just looked at the end of the 18th century. So within this, you know, I've used the word civilization, within this vast area where this culture, this civilization rooted itself, you know, I call it a civilization because of its extent in space. And again, common features, but diversity. For example, the language of Jews in all these regions was Yiddish. On the other hand, it was such a large region that there were regional varieties of Yiddish. So there's the Yiddish spoken in the Polish speaking lands, where the peasants were Polish as well. The Yiddish spoken in the northeast, in Lithuanian areas, in Ukrainian areas, again different. And with the dialectical differences, as different as my speech is from someone in the deep south, for example. And there were plenty of jokes based on the difference between the way a Litvak, someone from Lithuania, and then the way someone, a Polish Jew or a Galician Jew, Galicianer, would speak. So there's a huge area with regional differences. And then there's this same area, we're talking about roughly about 1,000 years, this extension in time, again with common features but with change, so that the commonality in this whole area was that, you know, Judaism, but Judaism itself changed in certain ways, so that at a certain point in time in the 18th century you get the development of Hasidism, which we'll come back to soon, but that also the same, but time brings various changes to this. Where do they come from? They came from the West, mainly. The great settlement came in the 14th and 15th centuries from Germany, from the Rhineland, primarily from the lands that the Jews called Ashkenaz. And that name, the names Ashkenaz and Sepharad are still debated where those names came from. So that we can call this the civilization, we call it Eastern Ashkenaz. Why did they come? Economic and political upheavals in Western Europe, a changing economy, first and foremost. Also persecutions, and I like to stress this, that the economic factors were first, because later on, and you know, in the years, in the 20th century, you know, you get Jewish, you know, when you ask your grandparents or whoever, you know, why did you come? Oh, the pogroms, you know, is the first thing that's said, and you know, in certain cases that may be true, but in most cases it's not. It's the economy that drives people. It's not violence, however extreme it may be. In general, it's political. You know, you come to, you know, because you can't feed your family, and this is indeed why they came. There were persecutions, yes. There was violence and expulsions, yes, in Western Europe. And what needs to be said is that from this point on, those Jews who remain in the German lands, and that's what we're primarily talking about, those Jews who remain there are very unsettled, so that if you look, say, 1750, you'll find it hard to find a community in Germany where an urban community where the Jews have lived for more than three generations. Totally different in the kingdom of Poland and Lithuania, where by the 20th century you'll find Jewish communities that have been there for 700 years. So it's an entirely different configuration, an entirely different way of configuring who you are in the space where you live. This Commonwealth of Poland and Lithuania, an ideal place, comparatively speaking. As I said, neither empire nor nation state, so that it's decentralized, it's feudal, so that local communities have a relative degree of autonomy. Its boundaries shift so that increasingly the lands to the east here are conquered by the Polish nobles. These lands is in the United States we talk about the Wild West. This was the Wild East for the Commonwealth. In Polish, kresy, which means the borderlands, or in the languages, other similar languages, Ukraina, and that of course is where the word Ukraine comes from. Borderlands, on the border, have a country that's actually called borderlands. So this is a country of an area of greatly mixed, great diversity, religious diversity. There's Protestants here, there's Muslims here, there's Russian Orthodox here, as well as Roman Catholics, which is the religion of the Schlachta, of the nobility. There are, depending on where you are, the peasants, Ukrainian peasants, Belarusian peasants, Lithuanian peasants, although those terms mean nothing before the end of the 19th and the 20th century. What you get are people who speak various dialects of which, and if you ask them, who they are, they say, "I'm from around here." This is this notion of nationality doesn't really come into reality until the end of the 19th century at best. In the cities, there are communities of Germans, the communities of Armenians, Greeks, Scots, as well as, of course, the Polish nobility that controls this whole area. And in the western part, the peasants tend to be Polish, meaning they speak varieties of what we recognize as Polish. And further east, they are different. So, and then finally, there's a need for what the Jews were good at. And what the Jews were good at was commerce and artisanry, right? Making things with their hands. So I like to stress that too. They weren't just commercial. They made things. They sold clothes. They made shoes. They carried burdens on their, in their carriages. They got to be good at transport and so on. So a very variegated line of work. So a vast geographical area, united for centuries under Polish rule. Within this area, during those centuries, a unique Jewish civilization roots itself, the civilization of Eastern Ashkenaz. What happened? Here's my watch. So now, how to, standing on one foot or sitting on one tuchus, so to speak, how to account for the strength of this civilization, for its continuity, for its creativity? And I like to speak of the four pillars of this civilization, and I invite you to visualize them as the four supports of a wedding canopy, of what Jews call chuppah, holding up the canopy of Eastern Ashkenaz. So first of all, number one, the characteristic pattern of Jewish habitation. From the 1600s to the late 19th century, this was the small town. In Yiddish, this is what's called a shtetl. And it's very simple. There's nothing mysterious about the word. The word Yiddish word for city is shtot, and you make a diminutive out of it, and you get shtetl. Now, important to stress, this was hardly the only pattern. Some Jews continued to live in the old cities, in Vilna, in Krakow, in Lublin. But the significance of those cities was undermined in many ways by the Schlachta, by the nobility. They was mainly interested in their own properties with their own towns on them. And Jews also continued to live, some lived directly among the peasants, in the peasant villages. What in Polish is called Wieś, in Yiddish Dorf. Probably the greatest literary person who lived directly among the peasants was Tevye. You know, in Sholem Aleichem's story, of course, on Broadway they put him into a shtetl. And that's very significant. But the characteristic pattern is the small town. And this is a response to a need rooted in the pre-modern Polish economy. Because the development of the economy in Eastern Europe was the opposite of what it was in Western Europe. In other words, medieval Polish cities declined, the landowners became stronger, and the result was a world populated overwhelmingly by landowners and peasants, and the Jews. Right, so the landowners lived in manors, and you saw a bit of that when you saw the castle, you know, with the location of the castle earlier today, and the peasants lived in tiny villages on the, you know, scattered around where the manor was, and the Jews lived in shtetls, in small towns, and what made us this shtetl was that it was built around a marketplace. All right, these were market towns, however small. One day a week was market day. Now again, even in shtetls, it was never shtetlach, it was never only Jews. Jews tended to live around the marketplace. As you went further out, non-Jews lived. Who were the non-Jews? There were some, you know, small Polish gentry, perhaps, Polish, Ukrainian, or Lithuanian, or Belarusian peasants involved in some kind of activity that they needed to be, you know, not far from the town. By the 19th century, there's hundreds of such towns with populations of several hundred, ranging to as many as 10,000, perhaps. Depends how you count. You know, there's no definition. You know, what's the maximum for a shtetl? It's an open thing. And these towns were between 1/3 and, in certain cases, up to 90% Jewish. By the mid-18th century, another way of looking at it is that 1/4 of all the Jews in the world lived in a Polish private town. In other words, in a shtetl. 1/4. That's a nice statistic. Many of these, the other thing that you know, again, undermining our established beliefs, these towns weren't all impoverished. The image we have is from the late 19th century, from Yiddish literature, and also from the reality. After a century in the Russian Empire, for example, a lot of these towns were impoverished. But in the 18th century, in the 17th century, these were often very prosperous towns, market towns. One way of sensing the strength, the economic strength of a lot of these towns is the building of wooden synagogues. And some of you, and building of synagogues in general, masonry also. But, and of course, when you come to, you know, go to Warsaw, you know, you'll see one of the most magnificent of those wooden synagogues, or at least the roof that's been reconstructed. But these were projects, building these synagogues, and there were scores of them built in the 17th and 18th century. Building these synagogues was a project engaged by a community that would sometimes take several generations to complete, right? So it required a commitment and an outlay of money. And some of them, some of these communities, tiny shtetlach, you know, where we would, you know, see it in the middle of nowhere. But they had the wherewithal, the economic clout to see this project through. So that's, we should divest ourselves of that sense of the poverty, you know, as oy, you know, they're you know, the, and this is what you get, you know, when you talk to, but again, when you talk to people who came to this country three generations ago from that part of the world, who came? I mean, those who were really oy, I mean, the worst, who couldn't support their families in any way. Those who stayed had some stake in the world and in that world economically as well. So another thing, a sense of that comes out of this, and that if you're used to a monocultural world, it is a little hard to, it's important to remember. We're looking at overlapping issues of overlapping memory, overlapping identity. For example, there's a town. Where is it? Can I find it today? It's not on this map. I'm thinking of what's today called Lviv. What's later? Może przerzucić to, no, tam do 23 roku. Tutaj może. Okay, so is there, yeah, all right, is that? No, it's not even, well, look at, oh, yeah, here it is. Well, no, it's not even on the map here.
It was on the
Commonwealth. Yeah. Lvov is a city, you know, it's not, all right, that's Lvov, there it is, Lvov, yeah, all right. So today it's called Lviv, you know, because it's a Ukrainian name ever since the fall of the Russian Empire, of the Soviet Union. And before that, after the war, it was called Lvov, L spelled in our alphabet, L-V-O-V. Before the war, it was the in the interwar period, it was the Polish city of Lviv. And before that, for all of the 19th century, from the partitions of the Polish Commonwealth, it was an Austrian city, so its name was Lemberg. And the Jews, in fact, in Yiddish called it Lemberik. And then if you go back before that, it was a city in the Polish Commonwealth called Lviv again. Now, those names then, hiding behind those names, though, but who lived there, right? So today, who lives there is Ukrainians and Russians, right? Who do not love each other one bit. And most of the Russians were encouraged to come in there because the Soviets, the Russians, the authorities were afraid of Ukrainian nationalism, so they wanted to break it up a little by putting a lot of Russians in there. So that's who lives there now. And if you go back, of course, before World War II, an entirely different population. Who lives there? Poles and Jews. Where are the Ukrainians? The Ukrainians are largely peasants. They live around the city in smaller places, and it's in typical fashion. The population of Lviv is two-thirds Polish and about one-third Jewish, and it's that way all the way back for centuries and centuries. Another example is the town. Oh, I won't find it in this map. It's not far from Warsaw, Góra Kalwaria. Which in Polish means Calvary Hill, right? Now, so it was named that because there were apparently stations of the cross there so that you could enact the Passion there. And you know, peasants would come from various parts of Poland to do this. I'm not sure of when that stopped being so important, but it was pretty important for some centuries until at the beginning of the 19th century, Jews started to settle in that town. And the Jews had trouble sometimes with the pronunciation of Polish town names, so they were always a little bit different. In the case of Góra Kalwaria, they had big time differences because no Jew is going to say they come from a place named after the Passion. So they simply called it Ger. Ger, right? And early in the 19th century, a tzaddik, right, a Hasidic holy person moved there. His name was Alter, and he did what was known as revealing himself. He revealed himself to be a holy person and founded, we'll touch on this later again, founded a dynasty of holy leaders, who in typical fashion were named after the place where they first revealed themselves. And so he was called the Gera Rebbe, and all his descendants were called after that, the Gera Rebbe, that generation. And the Gera Rebbe became one of the most politically powerful people in Poland. His son-in-law served in the Polish parliament, and the same in the interwar period. And meanwhile, and so Góra Kalwaria, meaning Ger, became a center of pilgrimage for Jews from all over. And on the holidays, you had an influx of, you know, 20, 30,000 Jews coming in to spend the holidays near their Rebbe. You know, leaving their families, of course, behind. So the entire economy of the town had to be, you know, had to transform itself, you know, for inns, places to stay, feed all these masses of people. So now you have two sets of memories. You see, for Jews, this was Ger. For Jews, this was a holy city. For Poles, well, Poles, if you look at Polish accounts of the town, yeah, there's a lot of Jews there, but we also, it was also ours. It was also our town of Góra Kalwaria. So you have really different, sometimes conflicting sets of memories here. Very different setup, because there are invisible lines here. And I just want to suggest one more invisible line to you. As I mentioned, you know, there are dialectical differences. So there's a difference between the way you know, Yiddish was spoken up here in the Northeast and the way it was spoken here, say. And so the Polish Yidden spoke one kind of Yiddish, and the Litvaks up here spoke another Yiddish. Now, one of the things that Jewish ethnographers started to do, mainly around Yivo, because Yivo was founded in the 20s, you know, so some kind of studies started, some very important studies, but they didn't really get a chance to be completed. Some of them were completed after the war. One of the things that ethnographers documented was, you know, was gefilte fish, right? Some people like their gefilte fish peppery and dry, and some people like their gefilte fish sweet with raisins, lots of sugar. And they tried to document whether that was a regional difference, and it turned out that it was. And it turned out that the Litvaks ate their fish peppery, and the Polish Jews ate their fish sweet with raisins. And what's more, when they drew the line between the two kinds of gefilte fish, it turned out that it coincided with the line of the two dialects of Yiddish. So unseen lines, you see. I mean, important differences in culture that really were not officially documented or just started to be. But, you know, lines within lines. And there's a, you know, there's a Jewish map, of course, of this too. So that was one piece. The other, pillar number two, something a lot of you know about, others know less about, halacha, all right, which is Jewish law. Halacha come, you know, from the root, the Hebrew root for to walk. It's how a Jew walks in the world. From the Talmud, other codifications of Jewish law, such as the Shulchan Aruch, but interpreted locally by rabbis. There's also an associated system, less powerful, of something called minhag, which means custom. Halacha was the key to maintaining a Jewish way of doing everything in life. Halacha applied to the life cycle. In other words, it told you, you know, how to be born. It told you how to be married. It told you, if you're a boy, it told you, you know, how the bris was to be handled. It told you, you know, how you were to die and how you were to be buried. It applied to the annual cycle. Halacha defined the observance of all the Jewish holidays. Halacha applied to the week cycle of the week, centered around Shabbat, and how Shabbat was to be observed. Halacha applied to the day, and a lot of these, of course, certainly applied more, vastly more, a lot of this to men than to women. The women had, you know, the men with 613 what was called mitzvot, good deeds, but these were things that you were supposed to do, defined halachically. The women had three. But as Orthodox Jews would say, they're very important. One is two of them concern Shabbat. One is to throw a little bit of the challah back into the oven in remembrance of the destruction of the temple when you're making your challah. Another is to light the Shabbos candles, and the final one that I've heard defensively described as containing all the other complexities of the Talmud is Jewish woman's ritual purity and all the many do's and don'ts concerning that. Yeah, please. This was the time. I mean, those things count primarily as custom, right? But certainly, they had different head coverings, the men in different parts of the, you know, beard and payas, that's halacha, that's required. The dress, not really, but it became such a part of custom that it was taken in. And the dress, as people say, was modeled after that of the shlachta, the nobility. Although I've seen images of the dress of the nobility, and I'm not sure about that, because it just seems the nobility was dressed very colorfully, often in imitation of the Ottomans, you know, with colorful just headscarves and sashes. The Jews were all in black.
But they were limited also. They couldn't wear every color.
They couldn't wear every color, it's true. But it depends how far back you go, you know. And by the 19th century, I don't think anybody would have cared what color they wore, but they didn't, you know. Is that...
I mean, are they ready with the short pants and the...
All that is local, and the kind of head covering. I mean, Polish Jews wore the caps, right? In Galicia, they wore more the larger, the shtreimel, which is that furred hat that today Hasidim say for holidays, you know, and is you know, that round fur hat with usually it's beaver or something, you know? And that's characteristic of Galician Jews. The head covering, But I'm not sure, I'm not even sure about the color limitations. They simply, there were at one time color limitations, but after, you know, a century, you know, you dress the way your father dressed, you know. And there's also, I can include that in the packet if you're interested. There's a very fine article I have on Jewish women's, traditional Jewish women's dress, which is the most significant piece of it was something called the Sterntichel, which was a headband. Often, you know, if you were wealthy, it had precious stones in it of various kinds, and this was very traditional. In fact, there's a very well-known novel in the 19th century called the Sterntichel, popular novel, and certain other kinds of women's dress, much less. Yeah, but again, that differed in different regions. You know, it wasn't always the same. The Sterntichel was common to all the regions of you know, it's complicated stuff because, as I say, it's such a huge region. There were so many local variations in dress, in speech. I mean, it was. So I'm not sure about the belt actually everywhere. Oh, the men wore the belt. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and so. Various kinds of blouses for the women. I'm just thinking about the women. I'll try to, you know, send that, you know, article in that packet. I think it's not a packet anymore. You're gonna get it on a drive. So, anybody else? Halacha, of course, applies to how you dress. Halacha applies, of course, to how you eat and what you eat and what you don't eat. Halacha applies to even how you do business. In other words, weights and measures. I mean, I always found this curious and interesting. Weights and measures in these small Polish towns were calibrated based on rules developed in the Babylonian Talmud. All right, so halacha was the way Jews managed for centuries to maintain in daily life that distinct Jewish way of living, of walking in the world. Now, halacha separated Jews from non-Jews, but not absolutely. All right, Jews and Gentiles came together. I mean, there's this notion that the Jews, you know, lived ekveld, you know, at the end of the world somewhere. And you know, if you read Isaac Bashevis Singer, you know, there's a, you know, the only Gentile who appears is what's known as a Shabbos goy, you know, with like stoves for Jews on the Sabbath. But it's important to realize that there's all kinds of contact between Jews and non-Jews. First of all, economically, certainly, very important, all kinds of ways on the market day, and then with the Schlachta, multitude of contacts, but also to a degree socially. There's Jews who you know, who would you know, who drank with non-Jews in taverns and so on, and were their friends. There's all kinds of course, but vastly less documented, you know, liaisons between you know, Jewish men and non-Jewish women, and there's plenty of that. But again, this is not something that we know a whole lot about. The example I like to give is of a Jew called a Dorfskayer, a walker through the countryside. He would be at home for Shabbos. Then Sunday morning, he set off with a pack, going from a small vyesh, from small peasant village to another, you know, but selling things, perhaps fixing a window because he had something in his pack. Where would he stay? He'd stay in peasant huts, you know, where typically a peasant hut was one room where the animals came in at night too, and the whole family lived. So. This is pretty close contact, right? But what? His wife packed him his food. You know, so that he brought from home. On the other hand, you can imagine that you developed friendly, very close, intimate relations with these people in whose homes you stayed. So that also, that kind of a way of getting at this kind of the way in which halacha separated Jews, but not complete. You couldn't separate yourself completely. Okay, you were in intimate contact with the people you lived among. Kahal, kahila. Kahila is the Jewish community, the organized Jewish community. Kahal is usually referred to as the Jewish council responsible for running a community. Typically, a community is in official documents, kahila kedusha, that the holy community of. The kahal was, every Jewish community had a kahal. It ran all communal institutions, synagogues, study houses, the bathhouse, very important, the cemetery. And it pays officials such as the rabbi, the shoichet, the ritual slaughterer. It finances this through taxation. What's the taxation of? Very important. Candles and kosher meat. People, poor people could do without kosher meat, because they just wouldn't eat meat, but no one could do without candles to light for Shabbos. And candles were a special thing, because illumination in those days wasn't even by candlelight. That was, as I say, that was rare. You would burn wooden tapers, you know, and that then people, you know, wouldn't stay up very late at night, right? And also, the kahal collected taxes for the landowner. Because, of course, let's remember, these were privately owned towns, most of them. Kahal was not democratic. It was chosen by Jewish male property owners, what was called balabatim. Some of you know, might have pieces of the word balabos, or maybe even balabusta, referring to a good homemaker. But balabatim simply, you know, in that world is the equivalent of the word, the English word burgher, you know, someone who owns some property. In addition, and this loosely linked to a particular kahila, to a particular kahal, a network of voluntary charitable associations called chevras that did things like bury the dead, marry off poor girls. For example, if you're an orphan girl, you know, impoverished, You couldn't be married without a dowry. So this association took responsibility for assembling a bit of a dowry for the poor girl, and then finding her, some kind of a suitable groom, aiding the ill, sitting with the ill, consoling families in mourning. Each of these typically a different chevra, which also typically of men. Some chevras had women, but typically men. And what did they also do? They also pray together. They daven together. So this was, where do you draw the line? This was a religious association that was charitable also, and its main function was charitable. In other words, these communities as a whole were substantially self-governing. All right, and now some kind of autonomy was typical of Jewish communities throughout the diaspora, wherever. But in Eastern Europe, there was a further step that was entirely unique, because there was a vertical organization, so that local kahilas would choose regional councils. And then these regional councils chose a supreme body, which for several centuries was called the Va'ad Arba Aratzot, the Council of the Four Lands, referring to four medieval lands. This mirrored the structure, the political structure of the Polish Commonwealth, where there was a Sejm at the top, then there were regional Sejms, smaller Sejms, certainly it was something Jews created, certainly by at least partly watching what the Schlachter was doing. Finally, number four is language. Language is crucial. And here we have to talk not just about one language, but two languages. And in fact, the linguistic system. And again, you can see I'm just standing on one foot. I mean, I'm trying to talk about, give you in 10 minutes, what the language issue situation was. So we have Yiddish and Hebrew. And more, we have a way of life that's rooted in the interaction between Yiddish and Hebrew. So Yiddish, largely spoken, but not only. We have documents in Yiddish going back, forever actually, especially since the invention of printing, when the rabbis said, those Jews who can't, read in Hebrew should be able to read in Yiddish. And so there's a literature that begins to be written for them, versus Hebrew, which is only written. And let's be clear, no one spoke Hebrew in this world. It was purely in written form. Yiddish, the language of every day, the profane language, and of course Hebrew, Loshon Kodesh. But it's not just even Hebrew, it's Hebrew Aramaic, it's the language of the books. Holy language. Yiddish at home. Yiddish on the street, Yiddish in the marketplace, Hebrew in the synagogue, in daily prayers, in important documents. Yiddish and Hebrew interact in the school, in the study house, right, where Hebrew texts are discussed, Hebrew Aramaic texts are discussed, analyzed, debated in Yiddish. And even more than that, Yiddish itself has a substantial Hebrew component for things that, because Yiddish is of course a Germanic language that's then taken east and develops all kinds of components, all kinds of words mainly, but also some of the grammatical structure from Polish and Ukrainian. But it also has a Hebrew component for things that you simply couldn't say in non-Jewish, mitzvah. I'm just thinking of something characteristic. Well, the whole idea of what did you say?
Mazal.
Yeah, mazal, for example. Yeah, I mean, there's. I was thinking of mezuzah actually, and there's a whole world of those pieces. So that Hebrew, actually, the Hebrew component is actually within Yiddish itself. What guarantees the unity of this system? Torah. In other words, as long as Torah, the study of Torah, is the cultural center of this civilization, these two languages, the linguistic system, remains a whole. Now, this is what linguists call internal bilingualism. What we are more commonly exposed to nowadays is external bilingualism, where you have one language at home and another language that you need to learn when you leave home, the language of the state, for example. Here, you have two languages for your own purposes. The minute you interact with what's outside, you need three and four languages. So, shtetl, halacha, kehila, Yiddish, Hebrew. The result, a seamless web in which things are that are separate for us. Religion, social norms, society, economic life, politics, culture, daily life are all inextricable, right? One unitary Jewish way of life, the way of Eastern Ashkenaz. All right, now what I've painted is a static picture, and now let's introduce some change. I'll also stop for a second, and you know, I'd love to have some questions if there are, and if not, we'll, yeah.
Thank you, and I'm curious about this region in particular. When did
it? Which region?
The Lublin region.
Uh-huh.
So you mentioned the migration of Jews from Ashkenaz to Poland generally, but obviously there's a really big distance between Lodz and Lublin. So why is it they came this far?
Well, first of all, Lodz take out of the picture because it was no, because you know, because Lodz was only created really in the mid 19th century.
But
where they came, the migration first, they settled. They tend to settle in the Polish cities, in the Western Polish cities, Poznań, Wrocław. Well, which was not even it was Wrocław at the time was in the was German even. It was Breslau, but Poznań, Kalisz, you know, Krakow was also in the West. And what happened is that in these cities, the relations, some of the economic relations typical of Germany still persisted. In others, there were German merchants, there were also Polish merchants and artisans. There's a lot of competition. And what happened is that as the Szlachta expanded east, so the Jews went with the Szlachta because the economic fortunes of the Jews were tied to the economic fortunes of the Szlachta. So the Szlachta moved east, and Jews tended to move with them. You know, so that Jews, there were Jews in Lublin, this I don't know, I mean, you'll find this out tomorrow, but the earliest settlement of the Jews of Lublin, I think, was in the 15th century, but may have been later. There was more, and as I say, in the 1600s and 1700s, the Szlachta did what they could to undermine the cities also. You know, and these cities, some of them, as you heard, had this thing, you know, privilegium of not tolerating Jews and so on. They could keep Jews out. But the smaller towns that were privately owned, the Szlachta loved Jews, and they simply invited them in. And so, but Lublin, I think it goes back to the 1500s. I'm not sure if there's somebody. Yeah, 1500s, right. We have a whole people. Wow. Debukim. So Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth is eventually dismembered. Because at least from the Szlachta perspective, it's too democratic. It's for the nobility, at least, and it's dismembered by its neighbors, which are empires. And on the eve of all this, you know, the last stand is at the very end of the 18th century. On the eve of all this, division of the destruction of the Commonwealth, we suddenly get a Jewish revivalist religious movement, and that's Hasidism. Now, Hasidism is a response partly to the destruction of the vertical systems of authority. It configures authority in a whole different way. There's a holy guy here, there's a holy guy here, and his people around him. It becomes horizontal. And also, there's a sense, here come the first rumblings of modernity, at least as modernity reveals itself in the East. So suddenly, you get a movement where, on the one hand, There's an emphasis on joy, spontaneity, song and dance, yes, as well as a whole new class of charismatic and politically powerful leaders. Now, ever since the end of prophecy 2,000 years ago, the notion that one Jew was closer, to God than another simply was not there. With Hasidism brings this concept into the world. This notion that the tzaddik channels, that's the holiness of the tzaddik, is that he's able to channel what's known, in the language as shefa, abundance, holy abundance, to his followers. And that's brand new. And this leads to a revitalization of Judaism. Hasidism at first struggles with traditional forms of Judaism. Some of them are the harem, the excommunication at first is declared against some of these Hasidic leaders. But eventually, by the mid-19th century, this new movement has conquered most of these communities, and it becomes the new Orthodoxy. So tradition in Eastern Europe is a vastly better placed to resist secular attack than it is in Western Europe. There's no comparison, and that's essential. Hasidism is a phenomenon, and even the way the dynasties are named, the Nasid dynasties are all named after Polish towns, and where they first originated. And so this is so no matter, they'll come to the United States, they're still from Ger. They go to Israel, they're from Ger, and so on. Political change from 1796 to 1918, there's no Polish state, division by the German, Austrian, and Russian Empire. The area is still agricultural, still feudal, but now the empire's work to break down Jewish and all local forms of autonomy, especially the Tsars. Still, a huge population surge. In 1800, there's less than 1 million Jews in this area. By 1880, we have 7 million. Now, there's a huge surge in European population overall, but the Jewish surge is much greater. So we have 2 million Jews in the Russian Empire around 1880, 5 million Jews in the Russian Empire, 2 million in the Austrian Empire. As we know, that's followed by a great migration from the 1880s to 1920s. 3 million Jews emigrate to Western Europe, to North and South America, to South Africa, also to Palestine. And today, right, as we know, nearly all American Jews, most European Jews, half of all Israeli Jews are descended from these Jews. Late 19th century, modernity finally hits. Capitalism, urbanization, all the goodies that we associate with modernity. This happened a century earlier in Western Europe, but there were vastly fewer Jews in Western Europe, and they were granted civil rights sooner or later, earlier with the French Revolution, later in Germany, but all this enabled them to enter these new liberal societies and states. They became Frenchmen, Germans of the Jewish faith. Now in Eastern Europe, a very different pattern. In some parts of this area, Jews were granted civil rights. In the Austrian Empire in the 1860s, in part of the Russian Empire in Congress Poland, they had various rights from the late 1860s. But in the vast part of the Russian Empire that was known as the Pale of Settlement, no civil rights for Jews or for anyone else. But most important here, and understanding what happens, in the modern period, is demographics. Jews were 10% of the total population. Compare this to Western Europe, the highest percentage was in Germany, 1% of the population. But more than that, 10% doesn't really do justice to the significance, to the demographic significance, because from 1900 up until World War II, over half of all the Jews in Eastern Europe moved to the largest cities. There they made up, as we've mentioned, about one-third of the urban population. So Warsaw, Krakow, Lublin, Vilna, Lodz, Bialystok, with 60%. these became major cities that it's difficult to imagine for us today, with where cities where all cities where one third of the population is Jewish. Many Jews still live in the shtetlach, and some still live in substantial numbers actually in Galicia still live directly among the peasants, engaged in various kinds of business. New mass movements among Jews, same as among non-Jews, nationalism, we get Zionism, socialism, Jewish political parties, new secular literatures, Yiddish, Hebrew, because wherever Torah is no longer the glue that holds these languages together, each one goes off. In Yiddish we say mach Shabbos frazich, makes Shabbos on its own. So that in the secular world, there's a new Yiddish literature, there's a new Hebrew literature, and the followers of each language, one side tends to be socialist, the other one tends to be Zionist, and there's new antagonisms in this world. Many Jews learn Russian, many learn Polish. Some of the greatest Polish and Russian writers come out of this world at this time. And Orthodox Jews start to organize too. For the first time, some of them proselytize, some form political parties. Then 1918, Europe, I'm hurrying a little bit because I want to get done. I want to have you ask some questions and stuff. And there's a little bit more to cover. The interwar period, Europe is transformed. We have a new Polish state with 3.5 million Jews. We have the Soviet Union with another 3 million Jews. And not to be, dismissed, Romania, Hungary, and Czechoslovakia with another 1.5 million Jews. In contrast with Western Europe, Germany, 500,000 Jews, France, 350,000 Jews, but most of these were immigrants from Eastern Europe. So now, just a little bit about interwar Poland. First of all, the greatest continuity with the past. I mean, there were 3 million Jews in the Soviet Union, but their lives were turned topsy-turvy and the entire culture was transformed. So just to focus briefly on Jews creating a modern society in interwar Poland, but one that was really different. We have norms based on what happened in the United States, what happened in Israel. This is a way of creating a modern society entirely different from what happened in the West, but which, as we know, didn't have arichas yamim, as we say, didn't have a lot of time to develop. Complex relations between Jews and Poles. Most Jews see themselves, they're seen by others, not as Polish citizens of the Jewish faith. There's a handful of Jews who want to see themselves as that, but that becomes less and less of a possibility as the interwar years develop. They're not an ethnic group. They're not hyphenated Poles. They are seen by themselves and by others as a nationality. Religious Jews see themselves as something that's similar to that, as Am Yisrael, meaning with a base, with a holy base. But still, the way to sum it all up in quotations is Polish Jews. They're a special thing called Polish Jews. Very different from the way Jews in the West, entirely different from the way Jews were seen themselves, saw themselves, and were seen by others. One third of this new Polish state are minorities. Right? Ukrainians are 15%. Jews are 10%, and so on. Minorities were given the rights to develop their own education, culture, in theory. But the problem, increasingly popular brand of Polish nationalism, starts to see minorities as the enemies of Poland. This was rooted in one particular influential political party, the National Democrats, NDECIA. In traditional times, there was little problem. Jews were part of the landscape. There were stable social relations based on relations between Jews and landowners, Jews and peasants. In fact, there's a sense in which the Jews were called, the population of Poland was referred to as the descendants of the three tribes of the sons of Noah. Shem was the Jew, Ham was the peasant, Yafet, you know, the nobles. So this, of course, didn't mean love, but it certainly meant certain stereotypes. But now, a desire by the increasingly powerful Endecja for a Poland that's all ethnically Polish and all Roman Catholic. They stress the need for an ethnically Polish middle class, because, you know, to be a modern country, you need a middle class. Look at our middle class, it's all Jews. So the solution that they preach is to push Jews out of the economy, ultimately out of Poland. That's also the stance of the church, from bishops to parish priests, with the proviso that you don't hit them, you don't beat them. The Endecja was much less fastidious, and youth groups connected to the Endecja were even less fastidious. So there were all kinds of violence that happened. The Endecja was never actually in power. Marshal Pilsudski, who was in power, he was certainly not an anti-Semite, and yet there were moments even under Pilsudski when certain, you know, taxation was passed that particularly affected Jews in various ways, Jewish shopkeepers and so on. But at the grassroots level, the Endecja, after Pilsudski's death as well, became in 1930. From the mid 30s on, became very, very powerful. Poles increasingly didn't see Jews as their own. The word in Polish is swoi. Jews were not swoi, they were not Poles. They were citizens maybe, but they were alien to the Polish national community. And that, and the importance of that, far transcended the importance of citizenship. Above all, Jews were perceived as a separate and hostile nationality living in a Polish nation state. By the late 1930s, amidst economic turmoil, the common opinion was there were too many, just simply too many Jews in Poland. Murder them all? Most Poles would have been horrified by that suggestion. But when the Nazis began to do just that, in a world where Poles too, let's not forget, was subject to awful terror, if not outright extermination. Some Poles chose to help the Nazis murder the Jews. Some, as we know, chose to risk their lives and their families' lives to save Jews. The great majority fell between these extremes. I and others used to use the word witnessing here. The majority witnessed what was going on. Now, I think that word hides a reality that's vastly more differentiated, and this on the basis of recent historical studies. There was a range of reactions, and we can have to look at a spectrum of reactions to what was going on. Above all, I would say this notion that they are not ours. You see, they're not our people, therefore not our problem, was pretty characteristic, and we're going to have a lot more here on discussing Polish-Jewish relations. So, Jews, of course, hardly felt themselves hostile to Poland. In fact, for the average Jew, this new Polish state represented an opportunity to be a citizen of Poland and at the same time develop one's Jewish identity. Because here was relative democracy, a situation in which Jews could develop all aspects of the old Jewish culture and the new Jewish culture. And at the same time, so that was like a positive thing. At the same time, there was growing anti-Semitism on both official and social. So Jews find themselves as well in a defensive posture. So Polish identity became off limits, even to those Jews who wanted it. We have cases, you know, of Jews, several generations of a converted Jewish family that by the interwar period were already, you know, were still attacked as being Jews. So that became less of an option. And Jewish culture, both for positive and negative reasons, it was strengthened. So the result was a vast political and cultural and social network with traditional elements, with modern elements, with synagogues and study houses on the one hand, with kahals, but they were now democratically elected. Traditional charitable associations, the chevres went on. Political parties, all of them competing for votes in national elections, local elections, and Kahila and Kahal elections. Socialists, Zionists, socialist Zionists. The Orthodox had their own political party. School systems. Over half of the children in Polish public schools, half of Jewish children, more than half, went to Polish public schools, but also there were Orthodox schools, socialist schools, Zionist schools, in which Hebrew and Yiddish, as well as Polish, were the languages of instruction. So Jews had to learn, I mean, all the kids had to learn Polish and to study Polish history. But often, in all other subjects, the language of instruction may have been Yiddish or Hebrew. Hundreds of free Jewish libraries, cooperatives, credit unions, orphanages, hospitals, newspapers. In Warsaw alone, at any one time, you could find at a newsstand 3 to 5 Yiddish dailies, 1 or 2 Polish language dailies for Jews, dozens of weeklies and monthlies, publishing houses, theater companies, orchestras, choirs, youth groups, sports clubs, cultural societies. And I like to stress, because we have this again, a stereotype of the Jew as this old man, you know, with a long white beard. This was a young society. There was a huge youth component. The energy of this society, of all these, of so much of what went on, was the energy of youth. Increasingly impoverished youth, in problems of various kind, but youth. And all of this run by and for Jews, and all of this activity in 3 languages, in Yiddish, in Hebrew, and in Polish. So all of this, in terms of, I think, you know, simply increases, has to, our sense of loss, our sense of what was lost, and hopefully gets us to want to learn more about some of the many details to flesh out what I just touched on.